inspiration to us all. And it's funny because me growing up as a Black African girl, most of my influences were from Brazil and definitely United States of America. Even though the language barrier was always there, you know, because we are Portuguese speakers, but we had subtitles in movies. But for example, in a music video, back in the days, we couldn't add subtitles on TV or, you know, go back and forward. So it's crazy for me, how can someone from a different culture, a different background, have this impact on other people from different countries, you know? Even though I probably didn't understand anything that was being said in the music and song, but I would be there, you know, feeling it and jamming. So yeah, it is unbelievable.
Well, sometimes you just need to see yourself, you know what I mean? Like, see yourself reflected back at you to remind you of your vitality, right? Like, growing up, we didn't have a ton of images, you know, where I could turn on the TV, never music videos, because it was never brown girls, but there were just very few, you know, models, actresses, singers that got like all the love, you know what I mean? So the few ones that we had, we, you know, like, you're, you know, I see you, you yeah. see me, and we are one. But it's just important to have that representation. You know what I mean? You know, I often find myself in all around the world, and you can feel very isolated, and you can feel insecure. You can feel like, maybe I don't, you know, maybe this isn't the right place for me. Maybe I don't belong. Maybe I'm not qualified, whatever the BS is that we got going on in our heads. And then to see somebody else, you know, that looks like fam, it's like, all right, I'm where I'm supposed to be. I got that confidence. But if you don't see that, you don't have that confidence to move through spaces that you know damn well that you're qualified for. And you create your own space that you own unapologetically. And the more people that see you, the more people are like, okay, I got this. I want to try. It's just important. Like, I'm obsessed with Black beauty and models and fashion and you know, so for me and so many people, you know, like me, you know, when we see your pictures and we see you guys like literally all over the world, and it's inspiring and it's exciting. Like, we're living through you guys, an inspiration for beauty and fashion and hairstyles and makeup and all that stuff. Like, it's exciting, you know?
And you are definitely one of those big examples, because you have a thing, and I believe I'm not wrong, but you were probably the first woman and Black woman that I saw paying tribute to other Black women, you know, with your Woman Crush Wednesday. Every single Wednesday, you post a picture of a different woman successful that is making her dreams come true. And that's very motivational for us all, you know, because we all have different battles. We all go through different, you know, kind of issues, depressions and anxieties. But when you see someone who actually made it, empowering and supporting ourselves, it's like, okay, maybe I'm going into the right direction.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, and it's important, right, to celebrate each other, because if we don't celebrate us, who else is going to automatically celebrate us? And this idea that if you shine a light on someone, right, it doesn't mean you're in darkness. It just spreads more light. And that, I think that we're so used to functioning from a place of scarcity and fear, that if you give it up for the next person, that it's somehow taking something away from you. So once I kind of got over that, and I, you know, cause I'm not going to say that I'm any different. I had my own hang ups and I was afraid of giving it up for dope women, because it's like, well, what about me? And it's like, you can be great too and still give it up. Mm-hmm. It doesn't negate your greatness or your beauty or your accomplishments or none of that. So for me, it's just become, I can't wait for Wednesday. Like today's a Wednesday. And I chose my WCW and sometimes I choose people that I don't even know. It's just legit people that I've found on social media that I become, you know, interested in their life. And you go down the rabbit hole of, you know, I end up on their cousin's page or their auntie's page because I'm just interested in who they are. And I try to celebrate those folks too. And one of the things that I was just talking about with some of my girlfriends, celebrating women who don't necessarily even like me. And people were like, well, why would you use your platform to uplift somebody that doesn't even like you? And I was like, because whether or not they like me is irrelevant. Their greatness is still there. Like their talent still exists, whether they mess with me or not. And they're deserving of praise. They don't need to love me or like me or mess with me in any kind of way or even support me back. That's not what this is about. It's about uplifting each other. And it doesn't have to be this exchange. Like I'm going to celebrate you and I expect anything back. It's you are deserving. And we got to always remind ourselves, you are deserving of everything good from birth. Right. And when you're living the dream, baby, I'm going to support you no matter what.
Amazing. Yeah. Amazing. Whoa, yeah. People, take notes. I'm doing myself, okay? And it's so dope, the fact that you are, you know, talking about this, because I remember when I started modeling, and this was probably in 2012, it was when I moved to United States of America, to New York. And I never saw such a competitive market, you know. I was in Europe before, in England, between London and Leeds. And when I go to New York, it's like a completely different reality for me in terms of how people take it seriously when it comes to work. You know, they don't play. And if you sleep, you may lose your chance forever. So back in time, I remember when I was doing shows, we would have probably one or two black girls maximum, you know? So this feeling of insecurity or not acceptance was always there, because we all knew that only one would be chosen. So it was hard, talking about myself, to make, how can I say? Well, as you know, Portuguese is my first language, and I haven't speaking English for the past year and a half. So help me if I'm making any mistakes here. So it was really hard to actually make real friends in the industry, you know, because all of a sudden, everyone was competing for that one spot. Yeah. And when you look around, well, most of us are in New York, Paris, Milan, London, by ourselves. No family, no friends. You have to start from scratch, you know, getting to know people. So all this process for me was the hardest. Like, I would see myself sometimes home crying, oh my God, I don't have friends, you know, and I was the type of girl who wanted to please everyone to be accepted. So yeah. The fact that you're seeing that and sharing this with us is amazing. It's just major, you know. I'm excited. So,
yeah. No, it's interesting that you talk about, like, you know, when they're casting shows and you know, different campaigns and stuff, and that notion of there can only be one, right? And if you are that one person that gets chosen, do you like being the only one? Does that make you feel better about yourself? Or are you that one that's like, I will not be the only one, and I'm going to do everything in my power with this opportunity to create more space and more opportunity for everyone else, you know, when I get that opportunity? Because, you know, when we go see shows, right? Me and my husband, I'm sure we are the most distracting people, because we count the, we started, you know, counting, you know, the black models. And then we start counting like all marginalized, you know, folks who are walking. And we're like, as they're, you know, when you guys are walking by, you're not supposed to be making eye contact. And we are damn near on the, you know, in the catwalk, like, hey, you know, we are the creepy auntie and uncle that are like, you go, girl. Like, we are, it's so exciting for us. And we know how big of a deal it is to be, you know, one of the few. One of the things that I was inspired by, we were in Paris during Fashion Week, and we saw a bunch of black models, you know, people that I had followed, and I'm like, and they were kicking, like they were like friends. And it was like the best thing that I'd seen in months. It made me so happy, because in my mind, it's like, there's only competition, because it has to be hard if there's only one person that gets chosen for these big opportunities. And there might be like 12 blondes who, you know, might look like the same exact person, but one black girl, one, you know, Asian girl, one Latina, like how that must feel to be one of the others that doesn't get chosen, and how it might lead to this
malice,
this negativity that you guys inflict upon each other. And so when I saw a group just like hanging out, having champagne, I was like, yes! And like, of course, I can't hold it back. Like, I had to go up, and they were like, yeah! And I'm like, you, like, it was the best thing to me, you know? Or when I, you know, we went to Coachella the last couple of years, and I see these groups of, you know, black models and entertainers and you know, influencers, whatever, everybody kiki, like that is the best thing. Cause it's like, okay, the next generation understands what we're up against, and they still, pardon, I have my potty mouth, they still fuck with each other. Like, and they're still about like, I'm not gonna let the competitive nature of this business affect who I embrace and who I break bread with and who I, you know, wanna hang out with. You know, when we're not competing for one job, and I'm not going to let that competition make me hate my sister or my brother. You know what I mean? Yeah. I hope there's more of that. You know, I don't get to see, you know, models that often. So when I do, I tend to be like creepy fan person, but I hope there's more of that. And that wasn't just like random sightings.
No, I feel like it's changing, and you and probably your fellow colleagues, you know, the fact that we can see this representativity and follow this example and this, so we can lead, you know, one day, it's important. It's important to have this during the process. And yeah, I see this. You have like lots of friends that are also actresses, like Megan Good and so many others. And you know, the fact that you actually embrace that gives us power, and as well as comfort, you know, okay, I should not be the only one, you know, I actually should work harder so more and more of my sisters can actually come in and feel also this acceptance of just being themselves.
Yeah. So, yeah. I mean, because the goal is for us to turn on each other, right? And take each other out the mix. So if you don't give them that, and it's all about, come here, girl, let me hip you to some game. Let me put you on game real quick. I'm not gonna let one job that everyone might want one job, right? But every so often there's a project that everybody wants. The reality is not all of us are gonna get it. And it doesn't mean that we need to turn on each other. You know what I mean? Because that's just the nature of the business. There's always gonna be one job that, you know, we all want that we're not gonna get. Rejection is a part of it. Keep it pushing. What's next? What we got? Have you, you know, like create things that allow you to give other people opportunities. You know, like I'm working my tail off during quarantine to make sure that when we come out of this, I'm creating jobs and opportunities for, you know, marginalized folks. And I can't look at my community as the enemy or as competition. I look at them as artists and
you can maintain this amazing body because I'm here eating like a pig, you know, chips and chocolate all day, every day to control my anxiety because we don't know when we are going back to normal for our regular lives. So I wonder, like, because it's curious, like, as a teenager, whenever you want to be accepted, either in school, in a new job, in a different environment that it's not your home, you kind of feel the necessity of being accepted. And one of the main things, or one of the things that speaks louder, is actually the way we look on the outside, you know? Mm-hmm. So I wonder, were you always comfortable with your body and skin? Like, because for instance, talking about myself, I started liking my body and feeling confident about it when I started modeling. And, you know, all these intimate clothing brands and lingerie brands started reaching out. Oh yeah, we want Sharam to do this advertisement and stuff. Because before, I used to hate it. Especially because, like, back home, African women in general, they are not too skinny. They, you know, they are curvy. Mm-hmm. So people always ask me, oh, are you sick? Are you eating? You know, yeah, plenty of time. So tell us, how do you feel? How do you maintain it? Because a few people commented on the picture that I posted. Oh my gosh, she's not aging. Like, what are the secrets? And yeah, it's true. We all can see now.
No, you know what? It's growing up, I didn't have the body that was desirable in African-American communities, you know, where, you know, big boobs, you know, tiny waist, fat ass. I was straight up and down. So for everyone who's didn't develop in their teen years, there's hope. When I got on birth control in my early 20s, I got a little bit of boobs, a little bit of hips, a little bit. And my body changed in my 20s that I was waiting for in my teen years. And I have buck teeth. You know, I grew up sucking my thumb, so I couldn't even close my mouth.
Oh my God.
I couldn't even close my mouth because my teeth were like this. So I had braces and headgear and all that stuff. So I grew up in a predominantly white community. So not only was how I looked not desirable to anybody, I was always the odd man out in terms of what everyone else considered beautiful. I was never that. I always played sports. And I think with playing sports, I looked at my body a little differently in terms of my body is built for me to do what I want to do on the court or on the soccer field or on the softball diamond. And I developed a personality, thank God. Not being the desired girl, I became a great friend, funny. I developed other parts of my personality that didn't rely on my looks because that wasn't getting me over. But these jokes got me, you know, I became more attractive to other people, men and women, for my personality, not for anything I was offering by my looks, because nobody was checking for me in that way. And to really get comfortable in my skin, again, it took me seeing more people that looked like me being thought of as the love interest or beautiful or desirable, that gave me the confidence to even dare to think of myself that way. I'm not just maybe the funny friend all the time. Maybe, like you might be interested, but that it came later. And so by the time, like, it all kind of came together in my mid-late 20s, where, like, I liked my body, like, I was confident, I felt strong, because, you know, coming from sports, I knew I had a good personality, I knew I was funny, it finally came together. But it wasn't until my first marriage fell apart, and I really started hitting rock bottom, emotionally, and not feeling desirable and feeling unlovable, that I had to figure out how to pick myself up and think of myself in a different kind of way than I had ever really thought of myself. That even though I'm not perfect, even though I'm perfectly imperfect, I am still deserving of love and respect and grace and compassion and understanding. And if you happen to think I'm cute on top of that, great. But just trying to attract more people into my orbit that aren't interested in the surface, aren't interested in anything that you can see. Kind of going back to how I moved when I was way younger, where it was all personality, all jokes, all intellect. And those people tended to form deeper relationships and deeper connections than the people who were just sort of interested in the facade. You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah. On the outside, right? Like the physical image.
Yeah. But I mean, it takes years, you know, and with every heartbreak, whether that's a work heartbreak, a romantic heartbreak, a family heartbreak, it's like you have to start over. Like you got to reset. And just because one day you feel super good about yourself and confident and like, okay, hold on, my back is a little straighter. I'm moving nice right now. Something can happen that it all goes away. Like you lose all confidence, and it could come from anything. It's how you get back up, how you right the ship, how you let yourself off the hook. You know, perfection should never be the key, should never be the goal. You know what I mean? That doesn't exist. Perfection does not exist except in an airbrush photo. You should go for the best version of yourself that allows you to feel free. You know what I mean? Sometimes beauty is a trap. It's a cage. You know what I mean? Your self-confidence, your beauty, your looks, your intellect, your personality should be freedom, right? It should allow you to move through any space like you own the space, like because you're so confident in yourself. And every time you get knocked off the horse, get back up, figure it out, straighten your back, remind yourself of who you are, and keep it pushing.
Like everything we do looks so easy and so funny, you know, like I wonder what's your biggest motivation? How do you maintain this great energy that you share with us, like on your daily basis?
It came later in life, honestly, and through a lot of heartbreak, a lot of pain, a lot of loss, a lot of time by myself, you know, like, as you know, we travel constantly. We're always in different areas of the world. You're always trying to find your way. But a lot of times you go back to that hotel room or wherever and you're by yourself. And when you're left with nothing but yourself, you got to figure out how to like yourself. And probably not until my 40s, which is why I'm trying to put you guys on to game way earlier. So you don't have to go through your life searching for something that is within you the whole time. So when I narrowed it down to, I don't want any opportunity. I don't want any relationship, friendship, job opportunity, nothing that takes me away from my joy, my peace, and my grace. Anytime I've sacrificed one of those things, it has led me to the worst experiences of my life. And that's really what has kept me in this space. But it's recent, and I hope nobody has to wait until their 40s to find that space. It's like you know that feeling that when you get introduced to a new group of people, that thing that shoots up with you, and somebody might just give off the wrong energy. Yes, and you know it. You can feel it immediately, and all you want to do is get away. A lot of times we override that feeling because we think it might lead to some different opportunity. The reality is when we override that little thing that pops up in our brain or in your chest or in your heart, that's a warning. That is your soul warning you away because whatever is at the end of that opportunity is not going to be good for you. It might be a nice check, but it might be a check that erodes your soul. And at the end of the day, you need to be able to recognize and live with and love yourself. And your soul should be intact. So anything, people, opportunities, jobs that make you question your joy, your peace, and your grace. If I need to cuss you out every day at work, this isn't the job opportunity for me. And coming to grips with that. And that took me a long time. Because to me, it's like, and I'm sure a lot of people out there, I have to support a lot of people. You know, my husband does very well for himself, and he supports a lot of people. And our money's separate. So, you know, all the people I'm personally responsible for have made me feel like I gotta just take any job. You know what I mean? Whatever job pays me that helps me, you know, take care of my family and all my responsibilities, I should just do that. But all money ain't good money, and all skin folk ain't kin folk. And it's like, you know, it, trying to figure out what is that thing that will always keep me on the straight and narrow with my soul. Your joy, your peace, and your grace. And you can feel it. You can feel it. I mean, True. You've probably been in so many different kinds of situations where somebody walks in the room and immediately you're like, I don't want any part of that.
I actually become super, well, I used to become super shy, you know? As I mentioned before, I wanted to be that person that pleases everyone, you know, that everyone is cool with. But yeah, you're right. There's a time in life when you decide to please yourself first and wake up, you know, and look around and feel that energy. You kind of realize that sometimes it's better to be by yourself than in bad company. In Portuguese, we have this thing. I don't know if in English makes sense, but that's like a statement that we have. Better solo than with a bad vibe, in this case.
Translates perfectly, yep. Same.
So yeah, it took me a few years as well, because I'm very needy, you know? My mom used to be a flight attendant when I was when I was little, so she was always flying, literally, inside of an airplane. So I feel like I always needed people around me to feel love, to feel that someone cares about me, you know? But I mean, for the first time in my life, by myself, well, not really. I've been by myself in New York in the first years when I started working. But right now, like, I didn't imagine that I would be here, away from home, away from family, 3 months straight, and dealing with myself. So it's been an exciting journey. I'm enjoying myself. Yeah.
I think you learn the loneliest in a crowded room.
Yeah.
You know, and it that sound, I'm amongst, you know, big groups of people that I'm supposed to be very excited about being and feel very privileged to be in the company of whoever. And all I feel is isolated and alone and purposefully misunderstood. And at this stage of life, it's not worth it to me. It's not worth it. If at the end of whatever this great, great opportunity is supposed to be, I feel like I'm lonely in a crowded room, not for me. Not every check that comes with more zeros brings more peace. You know what I mean? Trying to marry all those things, joy, peace, grace, soul fulfillment. And it doesn't also come with opportunities that might be the things that your parents want or society wants. It may look really different, but trying to figure out, what do I actually want? What am I actually passionate about? Not what I've been told I'm supposed to want, or what I've been socialized to believe I need. Okay. Now that I've deciphered what I like, my wants, my joys, my peace, my grace, my desires versus what my parents want versus what society wants. Okay. Now we're working with a baseline of what feeds my soul. And okay, let's move from there. And so far, I feel like I could say, I promise you, if you follow whatever brings you joy, peace, and allows for grace, you will not be disappointed. And that's people, opportunities, friendships, relationships. It all needs to feel like it's feeding your soul, not eroding your soul. Everything to everyone and nothing to you. Like, what is the point?
None. Yeah. Fact.
What is the point?
I just saw someone commented here like, fact. Yeah, exactly. That's the word. And talking about the entertainment industry, where people tend to get and physical. Do you think you will approach people differently after this?
Yeah, I mean, and it's funny because we were, you know, we're trying to think about potential storylines for season 3 of LA's Finest, the show I have with Jessica Alba, and not having any idea of what the world is going to look like and filmmaking is going to look like. I don't know how you film and maintain social distancing. I don't know how you film and keep people safe, like much less what kind of storylines that we can have where there's not a ton of physical interaction. Even, you know, being shoulder to shoulder with my fellow actors, much less, you know, I tend to get to make out with a lot of people. I don't know how we even get to that, much less how are we all in the same space and staying safe. So whatever comes, however we come out of this as a world, I think it's going to look dramatically different than anything that we can imagine. So yeah, I'm going to try to be open-minded kind of coming into this process and keeping all of that in mind. And also, you don't want to ever put anyone in a position where they're uncomfortable. You know, and I think with, you know, Me Too and Time's Up, we started paying extra close attention to, you know, romantic scenes and things like that. But now where it can literally be life and death, just having closer interactions with crew, your cast. I mean, it's literally over 100 people that put, you know, one show together. How do you keep all those people safe? So trying to figure that out, the new normal, is going to be interesting, but hopefully everyone goes into it with an open mind and trying to figure out how do we create storylines and create productions where everyone feels safe to create and go home to their families. So I have no idea what that's going to look like, but I'm trying to stay open-minded because this is unprecedented, you know, in history. So we're going to have to see what people come up with.
draw the line. I'm back, relapse, I'm fainting. Yes, what's that? The fact, I'm dreaming. Coconut oil, the center of your body still lingers on sheets. I got a shot at you, you wanna reach. Cop that, trigger release. Pop that top, take a sip of your holiest water. I know I'm a part of your flow now. Send me, you cut it, don't matter, you love her. Now you got part of her soul now. I ain't know them, but I know now. Apologies, dude, more than a few. The ones I ran through, but never loved you. I pray you found peace in your home now. I'm doing better, I got me a chocolate bar. Climbing on top of the bar. Think of the shape of the lick and the places. You only gonna lick when you rock with a fuck. Ever.
You lost in